Hi, I'm Yotam. This is joint work with Artem Khija, Konstantin Enya, Adam Morrison, Alex Lanevsky, Noam Rinetsky, and Sharon Shoham. And in this work, we want to prove the correctness of highly concurrent data structures. And the problem is, this is really, really, really hard. There are so many things happening at once that you need to think about. So what we want to do is to simplify the pen and paper proofs of the linearizability of highly concurrent data structures employing optimistic traversals. Consider as an example a binary tree with lazy synchronization, here based on the contention-friendly tree. It's a linearizable set implementation supporting contains, insert, and delete. It's a self-balancing tree, so there's a rotate operation, and it operates by allocating a copy of the rotated node. There's a bit marking logical deletion and a bit marking physical deletion. And the most importantly, the feature that we will be obsessed with throughout this talk is the fact that the traversals used by all operations do not take logs. So what's the deal with these traversals? Consider, for example, this binary tree where we want to check whether it contains the key 2. So we start from the root and perform a binary search. So we go from 8 to 7 to the left, and then from 7 to 3, then from 3 to 1. Then we turn to the right to see that the right child of 1 is null, indicating that the tree doesn't contain the value 2. And this is all very well, unless something else has happened concurrently that we weren't aware of. So let's rewind a bit to the point where the traversal was about to read the pointer from 3 to 1. And suppose that at this point there's a deletion of, say, 3. Now perhaps there's a deletion of 1, again modifying the left child of 7. Now perhaps there's an insertion of 2 into the tree, again modifying the left child of 7. Now the traversal wakes up, reads the pointer from 3 to 1, and then continues from 1 to the right, again seeing that the right child of 1 is null, and the traversal declares that the tree doesn't contain the value 2, although it really does. So older data structures avoided these kinds of behaviors by introducing synchronization into the traversal, so the traversals synchronize with writers to eliminate such strange behaviors. The problem is that the more synchronization you have, the less concurrency you have. So optimistic data structures employ traversals that don't perform or perform very little synchronization with the writers. And this approach has been used starting from the lazy list all the way to many, many self-balancing binary trees. So this is great for performance, but it means that we are left to deal with all these strange behaviors somehow. And this raises two questions. One, what does it mean for such optimistic traversals to be correct at all? And two, how can we tame all this complexity to actually prove that the traversals the algorithm performs are indeed correct? So in this work, we identify the challenge of optimistic traversals as the key ingredient in the proofs of many interesting concurrent data structures. We formulate the correctness of traversals as guaranteeing the reachability of some nodes at some point in time during the traversal, and we provide a proof argument that's able to generate simple proofs of traversal correctness from the much simpler property of traversal correctness without interference using sequential reasoning. And we apply this approach to simplify the proof of several interesting concurrent data structures, including list-based data structures, the logical ordering tree, the contention-friendly tree, including backtracking, and the Citus tree. So let's start by looking at the role of traversals and traversal correctness in the overall linearizability proof. So let's go back to the example we had before. And we want to prove that the binary tree is a linearizable set implementation. To this end, we define a representation function that maps a tree, a memory state, to the set of keys that it represents. And a key is present in the set it represents if there's a reachable node in the tree that holds that key and is not marked as logically deleted. So for example, in this tree, 5 is in the set because of the reachable node X. So we have this representation function, and the linearization point would be the single write in each modifying operation that modifies the contents of this set. So we want to prove that in contains, if it returns true, then at some point during its operation, there has been a reachable node holding the key. For insert and delete, we want to prove that they add and remove such a reachable node, and we will need to prove that other operations, such as rotate, don't modify the contents of this set. And the key point about this is that all this depends on the concept of reachability, which is defined over the entire tree and not something the algorithm can check atomically. And this is why the algorithm performs traversals. And we need traversals to be correct so that the operations would be correct and the algorithm would be linearizable. So we need to prove that the traversals have something to do with reachability. And it would have been nice if traversals just guaranteed reachability, that every node they encounter is in fact reachable in the tree. Alas, this is not so. Because for example, in the interference we've seen before, it is perfectly possible that before the traversal reads the pointer from 3 to 1, 1 is no longer reachable in the tree. So when the traversal reaches 1, 1 is no longer reachable. So it's not true that every node the traversal encounters is in fact reachable. One of our contributions in this paper is to formulate what traversal correctness means in spite of the fact that encounter nodes may not be reachable when they are encountered. So what do optimistic traversals actually guarantee? So the way we formulate traversal correctness is that every node the traversal encounters has been reachable at some point in time during the traversal. So for example, in this traversal, one has been reachable back when the traversal was located at 7. So when the traversal reaches 1, we can say that 1 has been reachable at some point in time during the traversal. So what we want to prove about traversals is that every node they encounter has been reachable at some point during the traversal, the property which we denote using this funny diamond. And it turns out that this traversal correctness is almost everything you need to do the entire linearizability proof of this algorithm. Because for contains, that's basically all you need to know, that the node has been reachable at some point during the contains operation. And for insert and delete, you need to know that, plus the fact that the node is not marked as physically removed, and the full details appear in the paper. We are now only left with the question of how to actually prove traversal correctness. Suppose you try to do it by direct reasoning. So for example, by a proof by induction on the steps of the traversal. So when the traversal takes the step from 3 to 1, you know that 3 has been reachable at some point, and you want to prove that 1 has been reachable at some point during the traversal. But when was this point? It's not necessarily now, because you don't know that 3 itself is reachable now. It's not necessarily back when 3 was reachable, because back then perhaps 3 didn't point to 1. So the proof needs to accommodate everything that could have happened from back then up until now when the traversal performs the next step, and this gets out of hand very, very quickly. So instead, our proof argument leverages the correctness of traversals in sequential setting to prove the much harder property of traversals with interference. And this works based on two conditions, single step compatibility and the forepassed condition. And the way this works, there are three actors in this drama. There's the reachability predicate, there's the traversal, and there are the interfering writes. So the single step compatibility requirement connects between the traversal and the reachability predicate, whereas the forepassed condition connects between the interfering writes and the reachability predicate. So let's see how this works. So the first requirement is single step compatibility, and this says that whenever the traversal takes a step, so here from P to X, if P is reachable, then X is also reachable. So this is not the same as we tried to do before. Before we tried to prove that if P has been reachable, then X has been reachable. Now we forget about that and think about everything in a single memory state. So now suppose that P is reachable and prove that X is reachable. And then it seems very, very straightforward, and it is. The only thing perhaps to note is that this can depend on whatever else is happening in the tree, only on the fact that P itself is reachable. So there's some form of locality here. The second requirement, which we call, for lack of a better name, forepassed, is about the interfering writes. And it states the following. If a write W reduces the reachability of a location, then from this point on, that location becomes immutable. So for example, delete 3 makes 3 unreachable in the tree, and forepassed requires that from this point on, 3 will become immutable. And in the algorithm, this is implemented by marking 3 as physically removed and other write operations validate this bit and would refrain from performing a modification. Similar things happen for rotations. So this is the forepassed condition, and together the single step compatibility condition and the forepassed condition guarantee traversal correctness. So every node that traversal encounters has been in fact reachable at some point during the traversal. In the paper, we also have a generalization of the forepassed condition that allows for some modifications after the reachability of a node is reduced, as long as these are performed in a very specific way, so they can only point to nodes that themselves have been reachable during the traversal. So for example, we could point from 3 back to its parent 7, because 7 has already been reachable when the reachability of 3 was reduced. At this point, you might think that I am cheating, because it seems like proving the forepassed condition itself is very, very hard. So I can assure you that I'm not cheating, at least not intentionally, because in the case studies we studied in the paper, proving the forepassed condition was very, very straightforward. Even if it weren't that straightforward, conceptually there's a way to simplify proofs of the forepassed condition based on traversal correctness. So the forepassed condition talks about sequences of writes, and you can assume the correctness of writes when you prove the forepassed condition, even though their own correctness is based on traversal correctness, because there's some induction on the sequence of writes performed by the algorithm going on here, and everything works nicely together. So overall, we discussed the challenge of optimistic traversals, traversals that perform little or no synchronization, and identified this as the main ingredient in the proofs of many concurrent data structures. We formulated traversal correctness as guaranteeing reachability at some point in time, and we provided a simple proof argument for traversal correctness, which we applied to prove the linearizability of several interesting concurrent data structures.